Shalom, 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 Yisrael. Yehonatan Dawit with you here, yahwehforchristians@gmail.com. It's a pleasure and honor to be with you again. If you go to the channel, you will see that I opened up with a video of the Tesseract. And I sent out on social media yesterday, I gave you some homework to look up Tesseract, and you will see why later. But if you want to see what it looks like, you go to the channel, and I opened up with a video of what a Tesseract is. We're talking about the seven seals, and this is a very detailed topic. If anyone knows me, I do not just rush through things. I get into the details. That's why I'm able to give you so much revelation. Ha, revelation. The book of Gola. And should this go over the 30 minutes, I invite you to go to the YouTube channel. This will be downloaded sometime today. And if we go over, because I do want to at least get to the first seal. The so-called Book of Revelations only made it into the canon because over 800 references are in it from the Old Testament. They did not want this book to be in the Bible. It was written specifically to the seven different spirits of Hebrews. There are seven different types of us. And as which that means there are seven different spirits of Yahushua. Now, prophecy, here's the thing that people don't understand about prophecy. Prophecy is not a prediction. Prophecy is cyclical. Prophecy is cyclical. And the testimony of Yahushua is the spirit of prophecy. Now, last week we talked about this throne room. Now, the throne room, when people read the Bible, we're reading, when we read anything, we're reading it in a linear fashion. But what they are seeing is not in the kind of world that we are in now. See, Tesseract is understanding of 4D. We are 3D, length, width, and depth. We can understand 1D and 2D, piece of paper is 2D, but a Tesseract helps us to understand the multiple dimensions. And this is how Ezekiel and Daniel and Yochanan are seeing these visions that they are writing down in a linear fashion. And we're reading it in a linear fashion. But when they see it, they are seeing it in multiple dimensions. Yahweh says, behold, I make all things new. All things. The heaven and heaven is not like it is here on earth. It is multiple dimensions. So that is the way we have to approach the Bible, approach the book of Revelations, is in a way that we have not experienced. We experienced a 3D world, but it is these visions are in a multiple dimension. Last week, I talked about the importance of numbers. I talked about the number 400, 30, 24, 17, 10, and 7. Please review that. Critical, you will not be able to understand Revelations while understanding the numbers. There's a whole, numbers are important. I mean, we have a whole book in the Torah, a whole sefer in the Torah called Misparim. Misparim, the book of numbers. If numbers weren't important, then what's wrong with Moses hitting the rock twice instead of once? Yahweh made the seventh day the Sabbath, not the third day. He made a set amount of paces the priest had to stand behind the ark. And that is critical, the number of paces the priest had to remain behind the ark. They didn't know why, but we find out later when Dawid planted the rod that Yahushua ended up dying from where he planted it. So numbers are important. Why did Dawid institute 24 elders? Why do we have 23 chromosomes? What would happen if your child had pairs of chromosomes from each you and your wife and there were 26 each? It matters, doesn't it? It takes two souls to create another soul. So numbers are important. If Yahweh gives a number, if you read about a number in the Bible, you need to pay specific attention to that number. It's a reason why that number was given. And the number on the stage today is the number 4. One of the most critical numbers in all the Torah. Number 4 is mentioned more in the book of Revelation than any other book in the Bible. It's 30 plus times in the Bible. And it is the answer to the lie. What is the lie. The number four is the answer to the lie. Genesis 1:1. It only took the fourth word in the Bible for it to start lying. In the beginning, God. The fourth word of the Bible, that's when it began to lie. And what did God do? Created the heaven and the earth. That, ladies and gentlemen, is the lie. Yahweh declares the end from the beginning. Shaitan is going to attack, starts his attack right there. I was looking at the universe last night, and it just pains me to see so-called brilliant and bright minds who are deluded and believe this wholeheartedly and are forcing our children to learn the lie. John 8:44, your father Diabolos is of his own resources. He is the father of lies. Yahushua says he is the father of lies. It comes from his own resources. Like Abraham, he is the beginning of the revelation to all people. Abraham is the very beginning of the revelation of all peoples. Shaitan is and all peoples of the truth. All true Ibarites, we come from him, people of the truth. Shaitan is the genesis of the revelation to all peoples of the lie. The lie. 2 Thessalonians 2:11. Yah sent, he sent a strong delusion that they will believe the lie. And it's critical to read the Bible, read the words, and specifically how they say it. It's not lies, it's the lie. So you, so for the curious soul, we have to say, well, what is the lie? It is the lie, not lies. So Yahweh sent them a strong, I saw it last night on watching cable, watching the Universe show. That is the lie. They are strongly deluded with all this education and believing the lie. Revelation 21:27. No one enters the kingdom who causes a lie. So it's saying specifically a lie. No one's going to enter the kingdom believing in that lie. In fact, in the entire Bible, only twice in the whole Bible is lie pluralized. Once in the New Testament, once in the Old Testament. So when the Bible is talking about lies, it's talking about the lie that God created the heaven and the earth. And also the lie of what it looks like, how it operates, the shape, the size, the age, the distances, all of those are the lie. I'm going to probably go a little more detail and explain it a little bit more. But in my second book, on chapter 6, I talk about, it's entitled Corners. I implore you to get that book and read the chapter Corners, where I explain in detail the lie and the truth of the planet, what they call the planet that we live on. You see, eschatology is explained by the number four. It took four, on the fourth day, Yahweh made the sun, the moon, and the stars. And what did that give us? Time. That's four. And this is the beginning of understanding of eschatology. Yahweh declares the end from the beginning. What do we have? We have days, weeks, months, and years. That's four. We have four seasons. In the fourth commandment, the only commandment, Yahweh says, Zeker. That means remember. The foundation, the Sabbath is the foundational marker of eschatology. You will not be able to understand Daniel, Revelations, or anything about the end times without first beginning with the Shabbat. It's like you can't have an hour without a minute. You can't have a minute without a second. So the Sabbath is like the seconds, the second hand. You got to have that first. It's the foundation for understanding what's going on today in your world of COVID. So this number four, how about the four elements? Earth, air, fire, and water. The four cardinal points of the earth, north, south, east, and west. No ball has a north, south, east, and west. There's no such thing as a north, south, east, and west and corners on a ball. Four creatures, the eagle, ox, lion, and man. I don't have time to go into this explanation of all that, but they all mean something. All earthly humanity will be divided in four divisions. People, languages, tribes, and nations. Why did Yahweh divide them in four people? How about the four horsemen, four angels, four winds, four quarters of heaven, four streams from under Eden? New Jerusalem's going to have four sides. The earth has four corners. The altar has four corners, four horns, four pillars. How about Yod, He, Wah, He? Four letters to the sacred name. And Yahweh Shua, the X-Man. And Shaitan is the T-Man. In my second book, chapter 8, I talk about Yahweh Shua as the X-Man and Shaitan as the T-Man. I go in detail because everyone is getting that wrong. They're equating Yahweh Shua with a curse when they put him on a cross, a T. He is the X-Man. All things go to that middle point of that X is Yahweh Shua. See, the theme of four is all throughout the book of Revelations because it is the answer to the lie. Everything about these seals and these trumpets and these bowls is the answer to the world's great delusion of God creating the heaven and earth instead of Yahweh creating the heaven and earth. And he says, I can show you better than I can tell you. Matthew 27:51-53, you rarely hear anybody speak about it because, you know, the Bible says everything must be verified with 2 to 3 witnesses. And you don't see really any other scripture validating this first fruits resurrection. When Yahweh Shua rose, others rose with him. But there is plenty of support of this verse, Matthew 27:51-53, in the book of Revelations. Who are those that resurrected with Yahweh Shua? Revelations 5:3-4. And no one, so I'm going to go into that, but I want to go to Revelations 5:3-4, because if you read that, you say, how do we get this message called the book of Revelations? Who qualifies? Right here it says no one does. Look, and no one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look at it. So I wept much because no one was found worthy to open and to read the scroll or to look at it. So how did we get the book of Revelations? If no one qualified to open up this scroll to give us what's going to happen in our day before he comes, how did it get done? We know that Yahweh Shua was under the earth. John 19:41-42, we know he was buried. We know Yahweh Shua was on the earth. He, after he resurrected, remained on earth for 40 days. That's important. And you read the Acts 1:1-8 narrative, Yahweh Shua was on the earth for 40 days. We also know that he currently is in heaven. I go to prepare a place for you. He is the brick mason. He is preparing the kingdom right now. We know he's in heaven. Plenty of scriptures to talk about that. So if he was on the earth, under the earth, and in heaven, how does he qualify to open the scrolls? Tesseract. I told you this, you got to get your linear mind out in reading. You got to get your 3D reality out. This is the Tesseract. Yahweh Shua qualified because of the ascension. In the ascension in Acts 1:9-11, it says a cloud received him out of their sight. The disciples was looking at Yahweh Shua as he was on his way to heaven. And it says a cloud, and that is important. I've been talking to you about clouds. The cloud that Yahweh Shua is going to come back on is that same cloud he went up on. And it's going to go not the way clouds go today. Clouds go from west to east. You can't even Google that. Your thumbs will not give you that. Ruach gives you that. But the cloud Yahweh Shua is going to come back on is going to go the opposite way. That's how you're going to be able to distinguish his cloud from all the other clouds. It's going to be going against the grain of the other clouds. It's going to go from east to west. East to west is the cloud Yahweh Shua is going to be on. That's the direction it's going to be going on. And it went out of their sight. It did not say it went up to heaven. Read the scripture carefully. While they watched the ascension, the cloud received him out of their sight. It didn't receive him up into heaven. That's how he qualified. He was on his way to heaven, but not there yet. That means that the seals started at the ascension. We are 2,000 years into the seals. That's when it started. Revelations 5, 5 through 14. I'm going to read it first and then go back and highlight some key words. Revelations 5, 5 through 14. But one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. Look, the lion of the tribe of Yehuda and the root of David has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose its seven seals. And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the four living creatures and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb as though it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of Yahweh sent out into all the earth. Then he," see, I'm highlighting certain words, I'm going to talk about that, "came and took the scroll out of the right hand of him who sat on the throne. Now, when he had taken the scroll, and the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and a gold and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints, and they sang a new song, saying, 'You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you are slain and have redeemed us to Yahweh by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation.'" See, people are divided into four different types. "And have made us a kingdom of and priests to our Elohim, and we will reign on the earth. Then I looked, and I heard a voice of many malachim around the throne, the living creatures and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, 'Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power, seven things, and riches, and wisdom, and strength, and honor, and kabod, and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven, and on the earth, and under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in them,' I heard saying, 'Blessing and honor and kabod and power to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb and forever and ever.' Then the four living creatures said, 'Amen.' And the 24 elders fell down and worshiped him who lives forever and ever." Key words. Remember, this is multidimensional. And I believe it's in 24 dimensions. I believe Hashemayim is in 24 dimensions. See, here's what a tesseract is. A tesseract is the four-dimensional analog of a cube. The tesseract is to the cube what the tesseract is to the cube as a cube is to a square. You know how you can draw a square on a piece of paper, that's two dimension. But if you draw the lines from the corners, you made the square into a cube. It's still on a piece of paper, which is two dimensions. What a tesseract is making the cube into multiple dimensions. Each side of a tesseract is a cube. It is a hypersurface. This is multiple dimensions. We cannot experience the world in that way. We can only experience it in the way we are experiencing it now. Height, width, and depth. But in the new kingdom, in the new world, we'll be in a hyper dimension. Look at this. The lion of the tribe of Judah and the root of David. And then he's also a lamb. How can he be that both at the same time? Now, if you keep on reading, he says, "Then he came and took the scroll out of the right hand of him." So the lamb took the scroll from the lion. Your brain is not going to be able to understand that without Ruach. So, David is the lion. He is going to rule in the millennial kingdom. Yahweh sure rules through him. But in the meantime, we're receiving the book of the quote Revelations from Yahweh sure as the sacrificial lamb. So he took it from the lion. He handed the baton off to him. They sang a new song. Only the 24 elders sing this new song and the four living creatures sing this song. Not all of us. Everyone, and only they are going to be reigning over the earth. Everyone cannot, you can't have a whole bunch of Indian chiefs and no Indians. Look specifically at the words us and them and we to see who is being talked about here. And then we see that he who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. This is hyperdimensional talk. The entire Revelations is hyperdimensional talk. It is not in order. You must understand what Yochanan is seeing. He's trying to give us a hyperdimensional activity in a linear fashion in writing. So it just takes Ruach HaKodesh to understand this. Yahushua says, in the ascension, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me. You know what I'm saying is true, because look at this. At the end of this, remember, Revelation 5, go to 14, it says, and every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in them, I heard saying, blessing and honor and kabod and power to him who sits on the throne. We know that hasn't happened. That's when the whole creation, everything that was ever existed on the earth, is going to acknowledge Yahushua HaMashiach as king, sovereign, and master. That hasn't happened, but Yochanan sees it right now and sending this to us. So that means this is not a linear activity. This is hyperdimension. That has not happened. Shaitan has not bowed down to Yahweh. His demonic angels have not bowed down to Yahushua. They have not acknowledged him. Sinners have not acknowledged him, but they will. They will. And by the way, we know that animals have never sinned. The creation has never sinned. Trees and birds and grass never sin. But only we sin. Therefore, all revelation given to us is going to be given to us via the representation of animals and the earth. We're going to get our revelations through them, the innocent ones of our sin. Now, I'm going to try to get through this today. If I go over, then just join in on the channel and catch it. So now let's go into this first seal. Revelation 6, 1 and 2. Now I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures saying with a loud voice like thunder, come and see. And I looked, and behold, a white horse who sat on it had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he went out conquering and to conquer. Key words, white horse, bow, and crown. Now, another, in these terms you must know to understand what's really going on here. Horse. Now, why horses? And only four. We got seven seals, but only four horses. Why? I gave you the answer in the very beginning. Yahweh is letting all the creation know that he created the heaven and earth. So four horses representing the earth, the square, flat earth, as the way he said it, under a dome and on pillars. The horse represents, and we talk about it as a collective, horses represent power, authority, royalty, wealth. Poor people don't have horses. Also technology and skill and war. This is high technology. And remember, animals never sin and the creation never sins. So we're going to get our revelations through them. Yahweh is giving us all this information through animals and creatures. Okay? But as when you talk about a horse singularly, it represents dumbness, disobedience, self-will, and individuality. Don't be like the horse as an individual. But as a collective, it's the opposite. It's power and authority. Now, I'm going to go to these key words, but first I want to talk about this anti-Messiah. Everyone knows that this first seal is the appearance of the anti-Messiah. We got 1 John 4 and 3. By this you know the Ruach of Yahweh. Every spirit that does not confess that Yahushua HaMashiach has come in the flesh is not of Yahweh. And this is the spirit of the anti-Messiah, which you have heard was coming and now already is in the world. While Yochanan was still living on the top side of the dirt, anti-Messiah was already working, which is why he had those Malachim had to send those seven letters out to the seven spirits of the Ha-Kal. Revelations 12, 15-17 is also important to know. Each word means something. In this Revelation 15, 12, 15-17, we know the serpent spews out water after Yah's people. The earth helps it. And the earth is the people. Most of the world is brown people. So it's easy to hide in this world. When we spread out, it helped us hide from Shaitan. What did he send out? A dragon pursued after those who gave the testimony of Yahushua. People think this serpent and this dragon is the same thing. No, it is not. The serpent is Shaitan, And he is one man in one place at one time in this three-dimensional world that we're living in right now. So he cannot pursue all of us all over the world. But he can through the dragon. A dragon is not a real creature. It's a mythological creature. So this is something that has been made and created by Hashatan. What is a serpent? Nakash. It's just a snake. Originally, snakes have four legs. We know that its ruach was able to be penetrated by Hashatan. And he was a certain creatures. This is why Yahweh says don't mix. Everything has its own kind, its own spirit, its own way. And sea creatures have a propensity to be able to receive demonic demons. And we know that when the earth was destroyed the first time with the flood, where did all the devils, where did all the demons go and fallen angels? They didn't die. They went into certain creatures, sea creatures in the water. We know that sea creatures didn't die. So Shaitan is able to make the dragon, make life by mixing. And this is called prenaturally formed creatures. Prenaturally formed creatures are something that's made out of a creation from Yahweh. And he makes beasts out of it, dragons, monsters. He's able to do that with his technology and through his specific people. Sarath is a burning, poisonous, fiery copper snake. People get mixed up with Moshe put on the rod. He put a copper snake that represented Shaitan's people. It didn't represent Shaitan. Remember, it also had wings. That is Shishabom. That's creation. These people, his specific people, and I talk about it in my book who they are his seed. And they dominate and rule with their inventions and their creations, and they are copper or brass, not bronze. So snake, serpent, and beast, and dragon all mean different things. A dragon is prenaturally formed, and it is a beast. It's not something natural. The white horse is easy. That's self-righteousness. People who like to connect themselves to whiteness are self-righteous. The bow, if you read it in English, you get it mixed up. This is not a bow of war. This Anti-Messiah has a bow. It's more like a wreath, and is produced from a seed of a mother. Ah, that's deep. I really like to slow down, but I have so much to share here. But this bow represents this man. He is produced from the seed of a mother. And this bow is made out of the most delicate of materials. It's not a war bow. He is not a warrior. He was made from the seed of a woman. Shaitan copies everything that Yahweh does. Yahushua came forth from the seed of a woman as Yahweh overshadowed Miriam. Shaitan is going to do the same thing to his anti-Messiah, his anti-Yahushua. He is going to produce her from a woman with his mixture and his creation and his inventions. So that's what this bow is. You need to study original words to get original truth. See, the Hebrew word for bow is different. It is an actual bow. Also, the dome is considered a bow. And Yahweh gave us that promise that he will not destroy the earth that way again, even though he says the imagination of man's heart is evil from our youth. When you look to the sky, though, we should fear Yahweh that he put this dome over us, and it acknowledges, just looking up in the air and seeing the heavens, they declare the handiwork of Yahweh. Looking up into the sky alone caused you to honor Yahweh. I've been saying for years, stop looking down at your smartphones. Look up into the sky from where comes your help. Look up. This is a testimony of Yahweh. This is why Shaitan attacks the dome. Outside of my office right now, I'm looking at the covered dome. Is all overcast. What is he doing? What is he doing? The dome is being attacked. The very face of the earth is being attacked by Hashatan. So, rainbow. Now, here's the thing about a rainbow. Okay, that's fine. I'm going to continue. I'm going to hang up, but then I will continue. Okay, thanks. Now, here's what people don't realize about a rainbow. A rainbow can only be produced as a reflector off of some kind of glass type source. So if you have a rainbow, the very presence of a rainbow means it's being reflected off of something. What is that reflection from? To this very day, man cannot produce a rainbow underground or in a closed-in area. You can only produce rainbow outside. You can do that with your own water hose. And you can make a rainbow as you spray your water hose in your backyard and see a rainbow over it. That is very testament of a dome above the sky. A simple rainbow testifies that Yahweh is the creator. It takes cognitive dissonance to not to believe in the creator. What is cognitive dissonance? It means an inconsistent thought. These scientists who lie to us about the universe are inconsistent in their thoughts. It is scientifically impossible to have a rainbow without a dome over it. And they know this, yet they still refuse to acknowledge Yahweh and lie about this earth, the size of it, the shape of it, and the distances of the space. This is the lie. Yahweh gives us the most simplest of ways to acknowledge who he is. Read the first few chapters of Romans. But there's other ways of acknowledging Yahweh that you don't even think about. The very breath, inhaling and exhaling. When you exhale, you're calling on the name of Yah. So I'm going to end on the broadcast. I'm going to continue on the YouTube channel. So until next week, Yehonatan Dawi, if you hear Shalom, Shalom. So continuing on the channel. So just breathing acknowledges Yahweh. When you inhale, when you exhale, you're calling on the name of Yah. And you cannot inhale unless you've been inspired. What is your inspiration? Putting on and taking off clothes acknowledges Yahweh. If someone truly does not believe in the Creator, they should not be getting dressed. Why are you putting on clothes? If you're in a good climate, a warm climate, why are you putting on clothes? Because you know it's shameful to walk around with no clothes on. Yahweh, when once we sinned, he gave Adam and Eve clothing to cover up their shame. If you don't believe in Yahweh, you shouldn't wear clothes. If you're in a nice, warm, comfortable environment, why are you wearing clothes? Because it is shameful to walk around naked. I don't care if you have the best, nice, tight breast, a nice, ripped six-pack ass, and you swing it with 12 inches. You are shameful to go around naked. And you can't do it. You will not walk around going to the mall, swinging and walking around naked, no matter how good you look. Getting dressed is proof that Yahweh created heaven and earth, that Yahweh exists, that he created us. Taking a bath is proof. Needing water to wash ourselves and clean ourselves is proof. You cannot just not take a bath, not wash yourself. So getting dressed is proof of a blood sacrifice because skins were made for them. And bathing in water proves that Yahushua is our propitiation. Blood covers your sin. Water cleanses you from all unrighteousness so you can't sin anymore. Currently, we still sin because we have not had propitiation yet from Yahushua. So, what is Satan's first attack against Yahweh? Remember, in the beginning, God. It took only four words for the Bible to start lying. It says, he created the heaven and the earth. What is the first thing Yahweh did? He banged out that firmament. He banged it out. That is the first thing Satan attacked when he was able to produce his own man. His first man against Yah was Nimrod. Go to the book of Jasher 9, 29 and 30. This is Nimrod with his bow and arrow attacking the bow, the dome of the earth. It's bow versus bow. Nimrod against Yahweh. Here we go. And Yahweh knew their thoughts. And it came to pass when they were building, they cast the arrows toward the heavens, and all the arrows fell upon them filled with blood. And when they saw them, they said to each other, surely we have slain all those that are in heaven. For this was from Yahweh in order to cause them to err, in order to destroy them from off the face of the ground. This is one of the reasons why Jasher is not in the Bible. This is attack. Yahweh let blood come down off the arrows. And what did Reagan do? What did Reagan do, President Reagan? Star Wars. This sinful, proud man has always planned on attacking Yahushua when he comes. They know there's a dome over the earth. They're planning on attacking him and fighting him when he comes back. just like Nimrod did, and it's going to be Nimrod 2.0 who's going to be the false prophet and leading this attack. So nothing is new under the sun. Yahweh declares the end from the beginning. Nimrod's attack against the dome is going to happen again today. Today. Yah separated us in four different groups. Then we had three sons. Where does that fourth group come from? That is Shaitan's man-made group. Yahweh separated us. How? By dividing our languages. How does man get us back? By uniting our language. How does he unite the language? The computer. 10101010. Continuous. Everything is a combination of one and zero. That's how I'm talking to you now. That's how we experience our whole world. Our whole digitized, computerized, technological world is all ones and zeros. That's what it is. And that's the covenant of Yahweh. Yahweh is all or nothing. Everything is right or wrong, one or zero. This is going to be the unification of the world coming together under Hashatan. So what are these classifications of people? You have people. That's Am, and it means to associate or huddle. So all those in the classification of Am, they have similarities amongst themselves with each other. Tribe. Tribe is mate. That's a branch. If something is a branch, that means it comes off of something else. So those who are in a tribe, their source is from somewhere else, and that is Yahweh Shua. Tongue. That's Lashon. The tongue is a tool for doing things with, like licking and eating. But here, it's calumniate. Calumniate. And that is to blaspheme. So there's going to be a group of people set aside who are just, their thing is blasphemy. Blasphemy. And then you have nations. Nation is goyi. And nation is something that's foreign. That means they're foreign to the people, foreign to the tribe, and foreign to those of tongues. Okay, so this group is the one that's probably the most infected with Hashatan. This is probably where he gets his beastly people from, mixing with animals and machine. This is the Goyi. And another meaning of Goyi is to mount up or rise and be majestic. This is probably the key of Shaitan's type of people. We know that birds of a feather flock together. Yahweh's dividing the whole world in four different types of peoples because each one got their own separate judgments that they must have. Yahweh gives tailored judgment. What about this crown? Just like the bow, it's not what you think about a warrior bow. This anti-Messiah is not a fighter. He's not a warrior. He's not a warrior. He's using that gay rainbow as his emblem, as his representation, and he has a crown. This crown, again, is Stephanos. It's like a chaplet. It's like a badge of royalty that you would get in games. So he must be an athlete. He's probably going to use the Olympic Games to bring everybody together. He's probably going to have some kind of stirring speech to unify the world through sport and hard work and all this kind of all the other crap they say about sports. So this is what his crown is. It is like for games and royalty. It's pomp and it's pomp and all that kind. It's not something from war. And what about and conquering? Again, he is not a warrior. This word conquer is Nike, Nikeo, root word Nike, and what we spell in English is N-I-K-E, Nike. Nike, this is not fighting and killing. This is to subdue one with a means of success. This is smart. Because throughout the history of mankind, Yahweh's people has always thrived when having known who the enemy are and fighting them. And just even us as a people here in America, when we was being raped and burned and enslaved, which we still are, but we were more religious. We were more family oriented. We went to church, we did all that. But now, we're subdued with success. We're so-called middle class. We have houses and cars and and bank accounts. We got our letters behind our name. We got professional degrees and work for the government. We are being subdued with success. He is conquering us with success. This is what this conquering man is. Nike. Remember, when Yahushua was talking about the seven churches, two of them, he gave them credit for because they hated the Nike, the Nicolaitans. Yahushua hates the Nicolaitans because the Hebrew equivalent to this word is Balaam. And what did Balaam do? He cannot curse Yahweh's people. Yahweh cannot curse or have anyone curse what he's already blessed. He cannot curse or nothing can be cursed that he's already blessed. But that doesn't stop us from cursing ourselves. And that's what Balaam did. He taught the world how to get us to curse ourselves. Nigga, calling out women's bees and hoes. We curse ourselves. And that is what he taught. And that's what the Nike, the Nicolaitans did. They help, but we can become our worst enemy. This is why Yahushua hates them. And he does this with us being, our guards down. Okay, our guards are down. We are fueled up with success. With success. We are not honed for war. So we are being pummeled, beaten down, by bleeding into the world and joining in with the world's offerings. This is Nike. This is Balaam. So Yahweh's people are destroyed for accepting the offerings of the world. This is what the whole mark of the beast is all about. The whole idea of the mark of the beast is buying and selling. Buying and selling. So Yahweh's people are like a toad and comfortable in warm water, a part of the world of buying and selling. This is the spirit of Balaam. This is the spirit of the Nicolaitans. So that, my dear students, is your first seal. And tomorrow, next week, I'm going to try to get at least two or three of these seals done. And hopefully we'll finish them all within two weeks. And until then, Yehonatan David with you here, yahwehforchristians@gmail.com, 443-306-3518. Shalom.